The whole idea here is that you can buy a ticket and cross the von Karman line, which is the agreed to dotted line over the Earth's surface at which you become, in outer space, and you can call yourself an astronaut. It's a suborbital flight, and if you've got another $400,000 or $500,000 burning in your pocket, you can buy a ticket. That's the purpose of this flight. But it also, when there's not people on board, they can fly it up and do experiments in the same exact capsule. They look at it's the same capsule, and they can do science up there with suborbital exposure to microgravity, far cheaper than NASA can do it. So they're doing both things. But it never plan. This is not a rocket that's going to take you around the Earth. That was never the plan. This is sort of like a Gilligan's Island, like a 3-hour tour.
So, Keith, what's the purpose from a scientific perspective, from an aeronautical perspective, of some of these privatized flights from Mr. Musk and Mr. Bezos?
Well, back in the day, I mean, we hear a lot of people saying there's either commercial space or government space. Companies have always built our rockets mostly, especially the big important ones, but they've done so under government contract, and the government has pretty much stipulated what they look like, what color, everything. Now there's been a shift more towards saying, hey, I need to put X amount of stuff, whether it's people, food, or science, into space. Hey, rocket companies, can you come back with a way to do this that's more effective in terms of using my money? And so far, it seems to be working. The Falcon 9 that Musk has developed is exceptionally efficient, is very cheap. And now we're seeing with Blue Origin again, he has Jeff Bezos, he's got a big rocket too. He's already launched it once and he's going to try again very soon to send two missions to Mars.
My father used to
So
go Apple.
different approaches, overlapping markets. At the end of the day is how can you put more stuff up for more people with less money?
What's the safety to the astronauts? I mean, we got a list of people going up. It says here one is anonymous. Paul, is it Taylor Swift
I don't
who's
know.
going up in Blue Origin?
Could be Lisa
Did it
Mateo. I don't know.
Vitaly Ostrovsky, I think, is with the Amazon. These are all people that wrote out a big check. Is it like a Saturn V where there's a real propulsion and fuel risk to the launch?
Anytime you get in a rocket, you're risking it, whether it's a little rocket or a big rocket, whether it's the one you play with as a little kid or the ones that these people will ride on. A. B. This was designed very specifically to take six people or some stuff into space, but I've done the training pretty much that they've done. I've ridden in centrifuges up to 6 Gs and I've done the microgravity. And when it takes off, you're being pulled back by about 3-4 times your weight. So your brain says, we are going somewhere. And it lasts for a few minutes until the engines shut off and then you're weightless. So it's quite a ride. I mean, this rivals amusement park rides, except
Oh,
instead of going
great.
loop-de-loop, you're going up.
That's a hell of an amusement park. I love having Keith on, folks. It's an amusement park ride. Folks, we're ready. I feel like Walter Cronkite. We're T-minus 4 minutes
There
and
we go.
counting
Very
away
good.
from the launch of Blue Origin here with astronauts. This is a manned space flight. Paul?
Keith, what's the role of NASA these days in our
Great
space
question.
program?
Well, since we're talking about Blue Origin, what they did is a lot of the technology that you see in this rocket or Elon Musk rockets or Rocket Lab or any of these other companies derived from all the basic research that NASA was chartered to do. They were chartered to come up and do these things first, and then, like a lot of government agencies, hopefully, hand that off to the private sector, say, hey, we just figured out how to do this. Now you go do it and build our economy and do cool stuff. Right now, with this flight here, NASA's involvement is minimal. They buy flights to do some suborbital research because it's much cheaper. They can literally walk up to the launch pad, well, metaphorically, but very close to the launch and say, hey, I want you to fly this thing to see what happens. And you spend a few tens of thousands of dollars. To do that on their own would cost much more and you have to wait longer. So NASA's a customer on Blue Origin.
Keith, what
NASA is a customer on SpaceX.
Interesting. Keith, I watched a little bit of For All Mankind, and this is where like it's like FACO, the Soviets get to the moon first, and there's a whole plot to it I don't want to get into. But Keith, what upset me about it is basically these astronauts, Wally Schirra, Neil Armstrong, the rest of them, are guys in Corvettes who drink a lot. What's the reality of the astronaut life at Cape Canaveral 40, 50 years ago or now?
Well, I was down there in 1981 when the first shuttle took off, and a lot of the places were boarded up, but it was still, they had that 60s look to it. I didn't see any Corvettes. I've met most of those guys. They've more or less passed on by now. I have a lot of fr I can say this. I have a lot of friends who are astronauts, and there's a little bit of the silk scarf left with the pilots, but a lot of them are adventurers. And yeah, I mean, one of the I mean, believe the woman who's flying today is a mountaineer. I mean, I spent a month at Everest Base Camp while my friend, who's an astronaut, climbed up to the summit. And I have other friends who've been submariners and done a lot of exploration stuff. You're moving more now towards people who do science, and also the people who know how to do the stuff that's all filled with the big words, science, when they get to the moon and go to Mars. So it's shifting. I think maybe a few of them, I know a couple of them have Corvettes, maybe have airplanes, but they're not driving around picking up young girls and getting speeding tickets
Keith
anymore.
Cowan giving us perspective here that only he can do with NASA Watch. We're T-minus 2 minutes, excuse me, T-minus 1 minute, 56 seconds, and counting. Paul from Cape Canaveral.
Keith, what's the next big milestone for just the overall space program, do you think? Is it the moon? Is it Mars? What is it?
Well, you know, there's a pendulum that goes back and forth, and I sort of have a neck ache over these years, like watching a tennis match. Are we going to the moon, going to Mars, both, neither, going? Yeah, right now it seems the Trump administration is gonna got back on the go to the moon thing, look at your watch, then go to Mars. They seem to have sped up or you know, shrunk the timeline here. But the problem is, of course, with the government as a whole, the budgets to do this. Oh, and we're gonna beat China. So, you know, that seems to be the thing right now, is we're going to go to the moon and beat China, and then we're going to go to Mars and beat China there. Except they're firing a quarter of the workforce at NASA and gutting the budget. So I'm not sure how they can accomplish the political means if their budgetary realities simply don't match up. But, you know.
Stay with us. Keith Cowan with us here of NASA Watch as he watches the liftoff as well. We're less than 1 minute away from the launch, 50 seconds and counting, as they say. This is Cape Canaveral. Blue Origin is a manned spaceflight with Jeff Elgin, Danek Karskazova, Clint Kelly, who has flown before, Aaron Newman, Vitaly Ostrovsky, and an undisclosed sixth crew member who asked to remain anonymous. Paul, you and I love the windows in the capsule. It wasn't like that on Apollo to the moon, was it?
That little tiny window on the door.
Now let's listen.
Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four. Command engine start. Two, one.
If you look on the bottom right-hand side of your screen, you'll be able to follow along for the timing as NS-36 heads towards the
chamber pressure looks good.
On Bloomberg Radio across the nation, on radio, the images are as you'd expect.
10,000 feet and climbing.
To me, what's so important here, going up 66 miles, it's not the big, huge flames that you associate with a NASA launch.
Yeah, you get different kind of ignition there and launch, but now the...
A little bit of a cloudier day out in West Texas today, but you can still see.
Ordered clouds
here. It's Florida. No, actually, it's Texas. They're in West Texas.
Excuse me. There was a surveillance correction, and that was my error as well, looking at original Blue Origin flights. Again, up only 66 miles, the Kármán line.
The
imagery on YouTube above the clouds. It's about as high as you get coming out of Newark.
Yeah, exactly.
You can watch speed and the altitude climb.
Easier. They had no time to wait. Right up, right on time. So there you go.
We welcome all of you. We're going to wait to see how this works out here. We're 1 minute and 30 seconds into the flight as well. Keith Cowing with us, and let's go back to him for a few more insights here. Where does this lead, Keith? Where does Mr. Bezos take Blue Origin?
Well, this here was, I don't want to say it's JV or practice, but they built a launch system that's very reliable, very safe. And he started from scratch, and that's given him a company that, you know, has some confidence in being able to do that. And of course, then the next step was, I kind of went from riding a bicycle to learning how to fly a jet fighter. They just said, all right, we know how to do this. And bam, we're going to build a big rocket because there's a market out there. And so they've had a lot of success, some delays. It always takes longer sometimes to do things. And it's a tired example, but I often use it. Back in the day when you and I, our parents, who said, oh, it's too expensive to fly to the, right. You know, the Far East. That Pan Am pioneered the idea of flying there. And after that became popular, somebody said, hey, I can make a bigger plane that can do it cheaper. But it's always somehow the rich people or the folks with a little spare cash that go and do things first. That's kind of what's happening here. This is ho-hum. Right. As a matter of fact, the other day when they said we're going to launch one of these, I typed yawn.
Keith, to Paul Sweeney's good question, what does Mr. Musk want to do? What is the Keith Cowing timeline of what Elon Musk is being more ambitious about?
Well, next week, Monday, apparently, we're going to see another Starship attempt. And they're trying to, you know, they take the approach that NASA does. NASA takes years. They launch. They make sure it's absolutely perfect. They spend a lot of money to do that. Whereas with Musk, they launch. If something blows up, they learn something. They expect things to blow up. They build upon it. It's product development cycles at a fast pace. Now they got to get to the point. They've cut some deals with NASA to say, hey, we're going to use this rocket to land your guys in the moon. And the last couple times, it hasn't exactly done everything it's supposed to do. So the NASA folks are biting their fingers a little bit. But you know, out of all the fire and the strum and drawing and all the explosions, you can get a good rocket. And I think that's where they're heading now. They have a new improved version. What does Musk want to do? He wants to go to Mars. But this money, apparently, in doing other things, that helps build the cash reserves to pay to go to Mars. So ultimately, he wants to go to Mars, full stop.